Hello, hello, hello! Welcome to IntraBlocks, your dedicated podcast to blockchain and smart contracts. I'm Waleed Alsakaf, your host. For this week's podcast, we're going to be discussing the rise of the autonomous economic agents with special insights from Fetch.ai. And I'm very pleased to have Humayun Sheikh, CEO and co-founder of Fetch.ai. Humayun, thank you for joining us today. Could you please tell us a little bit about yourself?
Well, thank you for inviting me, and it's a real pleasure to be here and to speak to you about such a growing industry, and thank you for your interest in Fetch.ai. I would like to just start with saying that Fetch is a 18-month-old company. We are developing solutions around multi-agent systems, and in doing so, we're utilizing the principles and the technology behind blockchain.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that introduction. So, as I discussed me here at IntraBlocks, could you please explain to our listeners what is blockchain and how does it work?
So I'd like to put a very basic format of blockchain. And as far as I'm concerned, and as far as what we're building with autonomous economic agents, a blockchain is just a record-keeping mechanism. Now, yes, it's a record-keeping mechanism, but what is quite interesting about this record-keeping mechanism is that people can join in and out of it, and you can have it pretty much decentralized, so you don't need a central entity to control it. And those are the key things which are quite interesting for us. And the final thing, which is why we have autonomous economic agents, is that you can exchange economic value on a blockchain. And that is the key differentiator from a centralized database or a ledger system that I would probably focus on during this whole conversation.
Thank you. And I think it leads very well into the next question, which is, in many of your publications, you mentioned that today's digital world is increasingly suboptimal. Why do you feel that is the case? Because I have a feeling it has to do with this transfer of value.
Absolutely. I think the transfer of value is, I mean, if I work backwards on transfer of value, the transfer of value has to happen for certain actions, services, products, goods. Now, the issue we have at the moment and the way we are today with all the technology we have is that we have different pockets of different things. And we are trying to connect these things, but it's quite a difficult task. I mean, interoperability is one key problem at the moment. So how does my accounting system speak to my taxi booking system? You know, it's, you know, just as an example, or how does my train timetable get connected suddenly to my assistant, and how does my calendar know about the timetable or delays? And so there is a very inefficient interconnectivity at the moment between different aspects of our lives. And what is quite interesting is that if you connect these different things together, you also then need to have this economic value exchange, because otherwise, how are you settling services? How are you settling products or any of these things? And this is where we say it's suboptimal, because you can't build a centralized system from top down which actually solves all of these problems. And as we all know, we're moving more and more towards software-defined systems. We're also moving towards autonomy. We're trying to make things autonomous. And yet, actually, although we are narrowly focusing on all these things, we are less focused on how do we bring all of them talk to each other? How do we connect to them? And that's really where our focus is.
So just to, you know, challenge you a little bit on this point about connections, because isn't that what APIs are meant to do? Aren't they meant to help disparate systems to be able to communicate between each other?
Yes, and this is kind of a move in the right direction, and this is an extension of the same, as we are saying. But APIs, you have to still write a software to connect to that API, and you also then have to take that information, and you have to do something from that data that you connected to. It doesn't really solve the problem, because now you're still building another solution on connecting two different things together or three different things together. What we are trying to solve is how do you do that without having the need to have that API connectivity developed every time you need connection. So, and that's really one side of the problem. The other side of the problem that we're solving is how do you find these APIs? You know, if you're on doing tasks on the fly, doing them autonomously, how do you find an API? And then you can't just sit there writing a solution for a new API. There has to be a mechanism where you can find these different things. Yes, you communicate through APIs, but how do you find them? How do you quickly connect with them? And in real time, you know, it's not, you can't do that, that you need something today and you'll write an API and come back to it tomorrow because you've solved one problem, but not all problems. So what we are trying to build is a bridge whereby you don't need to keep doing API integrations. You find the right more APIs and or services to connect to, and then you autonomously communicate with them. And then you already have a system in place where the economic value can also take place, the exchange can take place.
Brilliant, thank you. So tell me a little bit about who is Fetch.ai and what is your mission?
So our mission is, we would mainly call ourselves as a connectivity and intelligent connectivity solution. And let me define connectivity. Connectivity has three components. How do you find something to connect? How do you actually connect, which is more the technical connection, networking, all of that. And once you have connected, how do you connect economically? So if you use those three things to define everything we do, what it results in is different components of Fetch, which is, do we have a substrate where the economic value exchange, where the search and discovery, and where the actual physical connectivity can take place? And that's really what we are. We're a layered solution which provides all those three components.
Great. And talking about components, I understand that your Fetch is built on three components. One is the distributed ledger. The second one is the open economic framework. And third is the autonomous economic agents. So let's start with your distributed ledger technology solution. What's special about your DLT solution compared to the main ones which are already available in the market?
Sure. So distributed ledger technology, let me just explain why we actually decided to build it, because there's so many others,
yeah.
Right? So if you're going to run autonomous software, which is going to do search and discovery, which is also going to do a value exchange, you need and do all of that in real time. Then you need a ledger or a system. Let's not call it just a ledger. It's a technology, it's a system which you could actually connect to via the DLT technology, via the nodes. You can actually find each other. So there is an element of this search and discovery which needs to be supported by this ledger. And then you have to have a system whereby, if you think about the economic exchange is real time nearly. You know, it has to be very fast. And it has to be fast because all the agents which are actually exchanging value between each other, although the amount is very small, the frequency is high. The throughput needs to be quite high. And so things like, for example, Ethereum or any of the slow systems just can't work because we're not building a store of value alone. We're building a actual transactional, instant transactions, search and discovery, and settlement times which are very low so that you can do fast transactions, small transactions. The cost has to be cheap. The incentives have to be aligned. I mean, this is a big problem in a lot of the projects out there at the moment. Although the technology is great, the incentives are not aligned. The governance is not taken care of correctly. And for example, if you have the nodes, you know, who's putting the block together? I mean, you know, how is front running going to be taken care of? I mean, who puts the block together to then create the block. How can you do that in such a small time that the agents can cope with it because it's instant? So that was what was going on in our minds. And why? So now coming to the second part, why is it good? I wouldn't universally say it's the best, because I don't know, because there is so many ledgers. So I wouldn't make that assumption. However, I can more explain to you where I can actually do some comparison. So in certain systems where you use either the DPoS, you have this random beacon generation, because you have to randomize the block producer, for example. The current model which exists, let's say the BLS system, which generates the random beacon.
Sorry, what's BLS?
BLS is a system where you actually generate the random beacon, where what it creates a random number to choose whoever is going to mend the next block. So our system, in this case, for example, for whatever is available in the market today, is between 3 and 10 times better. Now, it depends on different implementation and around the actual cryptography, but we're quite comfortable in saying it's 3 to 5 times better in terms of speed, which means that you can actually have much better settlement times. So we have very fast settlement times. We have very fast block production time, and they're kind of the same, actually, in our case. And what you then deliver is a much higher throughput system.
Yeah.
We use the good bits of the DAG system, and we put that in with the blockchain, the actual chain rather than the DAG solution. We put the two together, and we create a model which has best of both, and that's kind of what is unique about our DLT technology.